from Nashville's First Church of the Nazarene. You are invited to join us in worship with The Real Life. Located downtown at 510 Woodland Street on the east bank of the Cumberland River, the life of Christ received, shared together, and extended to others with passion. For the next half hour, let us share the life of Christ together through the clear Bible teaching of Pastor Kevin M. Olmert. Let's go into the worship now.
Today, a child is born on earth. Today, the glory of God shines everywhere for all of the world.
Powerful, powerful song, solo in the choir. Be amazed is our theme for the brief message this morning, and it is truly an amazing story. I was trying to think back on some of the more amazing moments of my life in preparation for this message. There's a lot of personal things that, of course, pretty amazing. The birth of your children, your marriage, wedding, moments with God, special experiences you have. If you went back through your own life and tried to remember the most amazing scene that you can picture and re-experience in your mind, where that word amaze really seems to fit, And you can fill in the blank of that picture. When you first read the story in Matthew chapter 1, where we are this morning, Matthew chapter 1, starting in verse 18, it may not seem all that amazing. In fact, it seems rather simplistic. There's a popular word today in our culture called minimalism. It means that you minimize all of the excess and just get it down to the very basic foundation. It's very popular in drama these days. Remove all the incredible, you know, shocking props and special effects and just have actors on a stage with a chair or a table. And the power of the script and the acting has to create the drama, you see. Minimalism. I would dare say today that the Christmas story is a minimalist story in some ways. Let's read it again. Matthew chapter 1, verse 18. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother, Mary, was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife. Because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. And she will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. "And when Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife, but he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus." You know, of course, in the other accounts of the story in the other Gospels, the birth involved the most simplest of scenes, a stall surrounded by animals and hay. You know that the bed in which the Son of God was laid after his birth was not a neonatal unit of some high-tech medical facility, quite the contrary. It was in a piece of furniture that animals eat out of. It was a pretty simple story. And yet, as you walk back through this, can I remind you of the amazements in this story? The Holy Spirit comes upon a person just like you and me, a real human being, born a sinner, just like we are, into this fallen world. And because of her acceptance and obedience to the call of God upon her life, conceives in her the Son of God. That's pretty amazing. In fact, it is so amazing that scholars and theologians of other Christian traditions just could not accept that and have tried to make other explanations, such as, well, Mary must have been born without sin as well if she could contain in her womb the very God of the ages, Jesus Christ. But the story does not say that. Mary was a real person like you and me, who God called. And she obediently responded. And then the amazing miracle of the conception of God occurred. Joseph, a righteous man who she was pledged to be married to, who was more concerned about her than himself, That's amazing. We're living in a world where most folks only consider themselves and their own needs and their own images and their own reputations and their own stake in the game, not Joseph. Did not want her exposed to public disgrace. Determined in his own heart and spirit, in disbelief and amazement of what was happening, could not comprehend it, could not conceive of it, to simply deal with this quietly and privately so she would not be embarrassed. Pretty amazing. But then an angel of the Lord appears to Joseph, a supernatural divine visit to another real fallen human being born into sin, who now hears the call of God upon his life and who accepts that call and obediently responds and says, "I will carry out your will, Father. Deliver through your angel." And obediently responds and takes her home as his wife, knowing not only what public disgrace she would be labeled with, but also he himself. And believed in the message of God and became an example for us all, even as Mary is as well. That's pretty amazing. And then all of this done to fulfill what the prophet had said. In other words, this was not some recent plan of God that he had just put together at the last minute. No, this was his plan from the foundation of the world, as the scripture says. Only now being carried out, confirming what the prophets had foretold, happening even down to some meticulous details hundreds of years later. That's pretty amazing. And then the fact of why this God was coming in human form as both God and man. It was to save his people from their sins, verse 21. It was to fulfill the name Emmanuel, which means God has come to be with us, verse 23. That's astonishing stuff. And then the fact that she actually gave birth, and it actually happened as the scriptures have told us. What an amazing story. But the Christmas story makes one thing perfectly clear. God defines amazing differently than our shock and awe world. You see, God is amazing in transforming individual lives, and it happens in this story, which then influence communities rather than amazing communities with miraculous and supernatural transformation, which then influence lives. Have you ever noticed that? God comes to this world through individual stories, through individual lives, through individual experiences. God comes to solve these huge, magnanimous problems in our world, all the injustices, all the suffering, all the horrors that go along with living in this fallen world where nature is fallen and humanity is fallen and systems are fallen and injustice reigns and inequality is all over the place and it holds people down and back and creates all kinds of unfortunate divisions. Be a lot easier, the skeptics say, if God would just come and fix all of that and convince us through that that he was God, and then we'd believe. But God does just the opposite. God comes to individuals, people like you and me, speaks to us, calls us, transforms us. We've had all kinds of examples of God's calling people in this service this morning. Setting them apart. They've heard his voice. Their whole lives have been thrown into disarray because they've obeyed and gone, which then began to transform communities, you see. Frederick Dale Bruner, a Bible scholar who wrote a commentary on Matthew, he calls it the Christ book. He comments a lot about this, and it kind of had to do with last week's scripture as well. I didn't get to preach a long message on that, but on the fact that John the Baptist, well into the earthly ministry of Jesus, the one who had baptized him, was asking the question, are you the one that has been promised, or should we look for another? And sends his disciples, where he's in prison, to Jesus to ask that question. A lot of speculation why John would ask that. Was he doing it for his own doubts? Was he doing it for his disciples' doubts? A lot of things we're not sure of. But he sent them with that question. And Frederick Bruder points out that when you stop and think about it, everything Jesus did in inheriting the mantle, taking on the mantle of Messiah, did not speak of Messiahship. It spoke of something far less and far simpler than that. And could that be part of the reason John struggled? Could that be part of the reason a lot of us struggle? As he writes, John's difficulty with Jesus then is Israel's problem with Jesus to this day. Jesus does not seem sufficiently messianic. All the questions that can be asked of Jesus can be asked also of Jesus' church. And the church has the double disadvantage of suffering not only for her sins, which are many, but we also suffer for our obediences. Did you ever think about that? The reasons Jesus was nailed to wood are often the reasons the church is left in the lurch. You see, when we embrace the way of Christ, we raise the ire of the same skeptics that the Christ himself raised. Because he would not embrace the methods of this world to transform things we think ought to be fixed. And so the church suffers skepticism from both people who just don't believe, because we have not been who we say we are, but also because in some cases we are who we say we are. And we try, God helping us, to do things his way, not this world's way. And some say that is just not powerful enough for me, because you haven't fixed everything you ought to fix. And we say, we are here to touch lives one at a time, who will in turn influence others, who will in turn influence others until communities are changed, because that's Christ's way. Amen. What a concept. God is the God of amazing. But he does his amazing work in his own way. Think about that this Christmas. And we are then to be the people of amazement who live our lives in Joseph and Mary style, absolutely astonished at what God does in us and through us, and overwhelmed with amazement at what he's doing in others and can do in our world. That's who we are to be. The people of amazement, who never quite get over this, who never quite get over our astonishment, who live in some manner of awe all the time, that first of all, he would even recognize us or love us or know us. Secondly, that he would come to live inside of us. And thirdly, that he would let us be in his kingdom and create a place for us to live with him forever and actually use us to advance his kingdom. We ought to live in awe of that every single day. And we take it so for granted. For you see, we are the carriers of an amazing message. As Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5, we speak for God. That's not just pastors. That's not just missionaries. That's not just new young people called into the vocational service of ministry. That's you and you and you and you and you. You speak for God. If Christ lives in you, when you speak, God speaks. If Christ is living in you, where you go, God goes. If you are His servant and have surrendered your life to Him, what you do, God does. No pressure. But that's pretty amazing stuff, isn't it? That's why Paul says you're an ambassador for Christ. It is as though God is making His appeal through you and through me. You see, we are to be the transformed persons who pursue the holiness of God and love and serve desperate people in Jesus' name, one life at a time. We are to live lives absolutely amazed at God's amazing grace so palpably that it becomes contagious. We are witnesses to and influencers for the kingdom of God on this earth. And our daily question, and God help me to remember this in 2014. Our daily question every morning ought to be, who can I influence today for the kingdom of God? Who can I influence today towards Christ? Who can I influence today towards His kingdom? It ought to be the question we ask every single morning. I want to challenge you with something. The great news in all of this, and probably the most amazing thing at all, you don't have to create this. You don't have to, on your own, pull someone out of a desperate spiral going straight down. You don't have to save someone that is sinking and falling by yourself. You don't have to go in and try to create a God moment in someone's heart and life in the midst of, they may not even be aware they need God, they may not care about God, they may not care about you. You don't have to go in and create that atmosphere. You know what's amazing? Holy Spirit's already working. See, God has, if we can ever get, I'm still working to get a hold of this. I've been in ministry 30 years and I'm still trying to get a hold of this. We are called to join God in what He's already doing. We're not called to create it. Years ago, somebody said in a seminar, and I never forgot it, we're not called to create the wave. We're simply called to ride it. Nice thought on a December morning, isn't it? God's already doing His work. In the people you love and care about, that you're praying about, your lost children, your in-laws, or your outlaws, whichever it may be. Your grandkids, the broken marriages, the wrecked lives, the people who are struggling with addictions. Do you understand? You can't fix those people. But God is working in their hearts and lives in ways you cannot see. Would you be willing to join Him in what He's already doing? By surrendering yourself to the Christ of Christmas and say, God, I'll join you in how you do things. It's one life at a time. It's one message at a time. It's one opportunity at a time. It's one encounter at a time. And I leave the results to the God of the ages, who did not call me to save people, but who called me to influence them and witness them towards the kingdom. God will do the saving. Can we rest in that assurance today? And in all the troubled spirits that we have about our world, and all of its brokenness, and all of its suffering, all of the injustices, all the systems that are so out of whack, all of this world that operates so selfishly and so sinfully and so crazily, so immorally. Can we understand? God is working one life at a time to transform that. Let's join Him in what He's doing. Heavenly Father, These are days of family gatherings. These are days of introspection. These are days of perspective at the end of a year and the beginning of a new one. These are days of transitional moments in our lives. These are days when we're freed of some of the responsibilities we have on a daily basis that keep us from thinking about the deeper things. And we actually have some time to think about those. Lord, in the fleeting moments that we have like that, in the remaining hours of this year, would you whisper your voice into our hearts? Would you show us things we hadn't seen before? Would you show us people we hadn't noticed before? Would you show us hurt that maybe a simple stop and could I pray with you right now, wherever we are, if it's in a store, if it's at work, if it's at a family gathering, could I just grab your hand and just pray God's blessing on you right now? Something as simple as that could transform someone's entire season, let alone day. Would you help us to see how simple this is? And would we be willing to join you in what you're already doing? God, we are praying for people. We're praying for families. Yes, we're praying for communities and we're praying for our world. But now we're asking that you would use us. One encounter and one life at a time. To start making a difference. You're an amazing God. You do amazing things, and you do it in an amazing way. Thank you that we've been called to join you. In Jesus' name we pray. We all said, amen. This is Pastor Kevin M. Ullman thanking you for joining us today for The Real Life. For more information, visit our website at www.nfcn.org and worship live with us at 510 Woodland Street at 9 a.m. every Sunday morning. May God bless you.